Again, I'm going to train you that how in salivary glands you're all going to become masters by the time you leave this hall. So the onus is that you whether you want to take this or leave it. This is a very beautiful article which I came across when I was trying to make this lecture. It's all about pattern recognition. Today, how many were years you spent in radiology? You see cases, you learn, some cases get imprinted in your mind, and next time you see it, you got more confident that अरे ये ऐसा पहले भी आया था, it looks like this, let me give this diagnosis. So here I am to talk about pattern recognition of a lesion, and trust me, it is defined medically as a non-conscious recognition of a problem state based on patterns, and actually it gets imprinted in your memory bank that way. So let's see whether this helps us in salivary gland cases or not. So I was telling you this example this morning that calculi, you never miss. Cyst, you never miss. Endometrioma in pelvis, I think with history and by the look of it, you know that this is endometrioma and nothing but endometrioma. So that's called pattern recognition. So when are you going to apply the same in salivary glands? Clinically, anything is going to present if at all a patient develops pain, lump, or some kind of facial neck or lump, or he's going to feel discomfort about it and he's going to walk to your clinical suit. Talking about its application in the field of ultrasound, again with high frequency linear transducers, you can evaluate these salivary glands, especially parotid submandibular, and give a reasonable diagnosis in most of the cases. If not understood, again, as I said, CT and MR and all are to your rescue. The tips and tricks are very simple. Any patient walks in, three things you need to know: history, duration of the lesion, age of the patient, pediatric age group, adult age group, and what symptomatology he has come with. The most important crux of any neck lesion is not by telling where it is, but you need to know in which space in the neck it is situated. So once you have localized the space, your diagnosis becomes very, very easy. So parotid gland, parotid space, and submandibular gland, submandibular space. So why I'm trying to stress is that if you look at the parotid space, it has only five contents. So it's the main gland per se, the nerve, retromandibular vein, external carotid artery, and parotid always has lots of lymph nodes because of lymphoid tissue. Pathologies which always come from all these parts only. So if you have parotid gland lesions, they are going to look within the gland. There is going to be nerve pathologies, so there could be a neurogenic lesion coming from the facial nerve, and lymph nodes which are ubiquitously seen in parotid imaging. You cannot see facial nerve on ultrasound. So how are you going to put it as a landmark? Because it's a very important landmark to the surgeon also. So you're going to first search the vascular plane. So what's the trick is that you're going to search for the retromandibular vein and the external carotid artery. Facial nerve lies bang above it. Whether you see it, if you have a 16 megahertz, you're very, very lucky. But if you're using 12 L312s, which we commonly use in day-to-day practice, you may not see a facial nerve. It looks like a linear hyperechoic structure. The importance of it is, one, is that it divides the parotid into superficial part and a deep part. Now, mind you, deep part of the parotid cannot be imaged on ultrasound. So lesions which lie in the deep part are always only picked up on CT and MR. So this landmark is very, very important. Then the submandibular space. There is this mylohyoid muscle which divides it either into a sublingual space and a submandibular space. Very simple, and superomedial is sublingual and inferolateral is submandibular. If you even memorize this much, your life is going to be very, very easy. Again, contents in that submandibular space matter. So again, lymph nodes which are there anywhere. Because it's a submandibular space, there is going to be the superficial lobe of the submandibular gland, facial nerve, artery, and the 12th nerve and fat. So that's all are the contents of the submandibular space. Now, you need to also always remember that parotid has ubiquitous intraparotid lymph nodes. So many a times you could see a pediatric baby with lymphoid hyperplasia presenting to you, and you might see those lymph nodes. So now let's jump to cases and see how on pattern recognition we are going to pick up salivary lesions. So this young girl came to our clinic with swelling in the left submandibular region. Now when we started seeing this submandibular gland, see this homogeneous gland seen here, but see this linear hypoechoic areas. So moment I saw this, we know by our knowledge that this looks like to be multiple dilated ducts within the submandibular gland. You should not leave this till there, and then you should search where the Wharton's duct is going up to and see how beautifully you can see that there was a calculus sitting there. So calculus can be picked up very nicely on ultrasound imaging, and the dilated ducts, pruning, everything is seen beautifully on ultrasound. Then parotid gland, similar pattern, dilated ducts. See such a large calculus seen in the Stenson's duct. So you know how a calculus looks by now, and you can make a confident diagnosis. In practice, you will see more of submandibular calculi as against parotid. Submandibular calculi are radio opaque on imaging, and ultrasound is a great tool to pick up those stones. Coming to inflammatory condition, I was telling about this pediatric age group. You see lot of lymph nodes in these parotid glands which enlarge, and this condition is called as benign lymphoid hyperplasia. Now here you will see a gland which is full of these hypoechoic areas which are nothing but the nodes which get enlarged. Now an important take home, the background of this gland is completely normal. So when the background is normal, pediatric age group, lymph nodes enlarge, this is benign lymphoid hyperplasia. See this, very beautifully you will see multiple hypoechoic areas seen within it. In fact, many a times you will see enlarged level 2 nodes within the neck. So putting 2 and 2 together, you can say it as a lymphoid hyperplasia. Then the most commonest seen in day-to-day practice is silent anitis. So patient is going to present with pain, swelling. So the gland is going to look enlarged. It's going to look heterogeneous. If you put Doppler, it's going to look vascular. There is going to be typically level 2 nodes, jugulodigastic nodes. And when you have an history in setting, and you're going to write it as acute silent anitis. Now here, the most commonly in practice, what we see is parotid involvement in silent anitis, which is most commonly bacterial. Now the causes could be huge, the organisms are multifactorial, but what's more important is always follow up cases of silent anitis, because they are prone to secondary complications like formation of an abscess, and they usually have sometimes even painful cervical nodes which enlarge and suppurate. So always ask for a follow up in all cases of silent anitis. Viral infections also can affect the glands, where typically there is bilateral involvement, there are level 2 nodes, and even they can undergo secondary complications in terms of abscess formation. How do you see? You have typically a child with mumps diagnosed by the clinician. How you see it on imaging? You will see this typical rounded spots all involving the parotid glands, sometimes even the submandibular glands, and that is a characteristic of a viral silent anitis. Then sometimes in pediatric age groups, there are suppurations of the lymph nodes, and these lymph nodes become so liquefied and necrotic that they form a large lymph nodal mass, and this can also present to you as a painful lump. And these necrotic nodes with an suppurated lymph nodal mass, you need to tell the clinician or the surgeon two things. One, whether these lymph nodes have completely gone under suppuration, because then it is only amenable to surgical excision. But if not, they are put on high dose antibiotics, and patient is then asked for a follow up. Sometimes they settle with good heavy antibiotics, but if not, then they have to be excised. In fact, at times there is something called as pansyloidinitis, where submandibular parotid, everything gets involved, badly inflamed glands, and you will see lot of vascularity on imaging, patient with severely toxic pain, fever. Putting two and two into picture of a clinical scenario, you can write this diagnosis of a pansyloidinitis. Then chronic inflammatory conditions involving the salivary glands. You all know of Jogren's. So it's going to be a classical, a 40 or a 50 year old female, typically presenting with keratoconjunctivitis, sicca, dry eyes, dry mouth. So see how important is history here. You are always going to do imaging of the parotid and submandibular glands. But what is your intention of doing this imaging? One is to rule out salivary gland involvement of a Jogren's. But the most important take home that Jogren's cases, parotid lymphomas are very, very highly associated. So your job as an imaging specialist is to rule out an associated lymphoma with Jogren's. So again, see how this looks. Doesn't it look typically like the sialadenitis? But here there is a female with a dry eyes, dry mouth syndrome, and typically hypoechoic spots seen all around the parotid glands with a background history. You're going to report it as a Jogren's involvement of parotid gland. So the spectrum of looking of these morphologies is same. Sialadenitis with pain, swelling, fever. Then lymphoid hyperplasia, the way I showed you. The third thing is this condition called Jogren's. But with a female and a background history known to you, you can make a confident diagnosis of a Jogren's involvement of parotid. 20 days back, we had a sarcoidosis involving the liver. And in those patients also submandibular gland involvement of sarcoidosis is known. In fact, they have seen that glands look normal. But if you do histopathology of those glands, in most of the cases, you will see sarcoid elements in the submandibular glands. Cox in India can be anywhere and everywhere. Now, how this cox is going to affect salivary glands is in two ways. One, within the parenchyma itself or periparotid. For example, the area around the parotid gland, and that can cause a very confusing picture. So primary TB involving the salivary glands is quite rare, but the secondary ones are very, very common, and they can typically involve a submandibular or a submandibular glands. Now what are you going to see is you're going to see a dirty collection with internal echoes cavities. Now it might be very technically difficult for you to distinguish it from an abscess, but a cold abscess, you need to do an FNA or biopsy to rule out the same. So see this case, which was a huge collection, dirty echoes seen within the submandibular glands, and see, it had completely eroded the mandible. Can you appreciate this? See how beautifully on ultrasound you can pick up these erosions, and this was Cox.